Good morning, church.
Good morning.
It is good to see everyone this morning. We welcome you to Gillsburg Baptist Church. If you're visiting with us, we want you to know you are a very special guest, and you're welcome here at any time, and we're so glad you chose to worship with us this morning. If you would, please pull out your bulletin, go through a few announcements this morning before we get our service kicked off. I want to remind everyone and the homemakers and God's men that fellowship is tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock. So the homemakers and God's men's fellowship tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock, if you're a part of those two groups. Wednesday night will be our business meeting. Supper will be served at 5:30. The business meeting will kick off at 6, and that's when the youth and GAs and RAs will break into their groups. And then at 6:30 is choir practice. So Wednesday night, 5:30, supper is served. Business meeting at 6, and 6:30 is choir practice. Also want to announce that we've got choir practice Wednesday at 6:30, but also have choir practice next Sunday evening at 6 o'clock. Next Sunday evening at 6 o'clock, preparing for Easter music. Also want you to know, if you have kids or grandkids, newborn to 6th grade, the Easter egg hunt will be here April 16th at 10 o'clock. April 16th. 10 a.m., the Easter egg hunt, newborn to 6th grade. The weekend before that, which I believe is the 9th, we will be going to Terry's Creek to be there at Terry's Creek at 10 o'clock. So if you want to be a part of that, meet us out at Terry's Creek or meet here. Just meet us out at Terry's Creek at 10 o'clock if you want to be a part of that. We're teaming up with Terry's Creek on some Easter stuff on the 9th. April the 9th, so if you want to be a part of that or bring your kids to that, just be out at Terry's Creek at 10 o'clock. And then remember, the 16th will be here at Gillsburg at 10 o'clock, the Easter egg hunt. We remind everyone about our Annie Armstrong Easter offering for North American Missions. Our goal here is $3,500. If you will pray about that, meditate on that, if you feel led to give to that, please do so. You can put a little note on your check, or you could probably also do that online as well if you would like to do that. Now, VBS, we have changed the dates on VBS. So the previous dates that were announced to you, those dates have now changed. The new dates to VBS are June the 20th through the 24th. June the 20th through the 24th, Monday through Friday, 8:30 a.m. to 12:30 p.m., correct? Did I get that right? June 20th through 24th. Monday through Friday, 8:30 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. For VBS. So if you have signed up to help with that or work with that, or if you have kids or grandkids coming to be a part of that, we have changed those dates, and those are the new dates. VBS, June 20th through the 24th. I believe we have most teacher spots filled. What we need now, if you still want to help or be a part of that, we have some places we can fill in with helpers. Helping out lead groups or be a part of classes or something. So if you want to help, please see Ashley and do that. But those that have already signed up to teach all the classes, we appreciate you and thank you for your faithfulness. Any other announcements that I need to make this morning before I introduce to you Miss Amy Giacconi? If not, I know she is no stranger to Gillsburg. Now, she has blessed us many times, and I know she'll continue to do the same today. But Miss Amy Giacconi is visiting with us today to present some special music. So we want to welcome Amy back, and I know you want to say something to her after the service. But as she's coming up here, I'd ask that you bow with me in prayer as we kick off the service this morning. Father, we love you and we thank you, and we're truly grateful for the opportunity to come out and worship you this morning. We just lift you up during this time, Lord. It's all about you. We just pray that the music that is sung brings glory and honor to your name. We just pray, Lord, that you will deliver to us the message that you'd have us hear through Brother Vic. We just pray that you'll keep us safe as we're here worshiping, Lord, and keep us safe as we depart here. Our prayer, Lord, if there's someone here that doesn't know you, that they'll come to know you this morning by the way that we worship you. We just ask, Lord, that you forgive us where we fail you, Lord. And we pray all this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Something else she's going to bring for us a little bit later. I'm sure you enjoy too. We shall behold him face to face. Isn't that a great thought? We're going to concentrate a little bit on that call to worship when it came, his triumphal entry to Jerusalem. Everybody was on the side of the street saying, blessed be the name of the Lord. That's saying the power and strength in the name of the Lord. That's the thing we sing.
There is fire in the name of the Lord. There
the Lord. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
No prayer? Oh, I didn't look. Okay, my little buddies, come on down. Miss LaWanda's all confused. What else is new, huh, Salem? Oops. Okie dokie, look what a good crowd. Well, proud of you. Okay. Hallelujah.
Jesus is alive.
Hallelujah.
Jesus is alive.
Oh, I'm so excited. Jesus is alive. You know, we're coming up on Easter. What does our painting over there say?
He has risen.
What does that mean?
He has come alive.
He's not dead in the grave anymore?
No, he moved.
He moved? Where'd he move to, Salem? He moved to heaven. Great answer, Maggie. All right. We're going to do a little thing today. We're going to pretend this quarter is Jesus, okay? Okay. I'm going to tell y'all the story about Jesus getting crucified. When Jesus came down off that middle cross there, they took him and they took him to a grave, right? So, I'm going to put Jesus, they put him in some clothes, some white clothes to bury him in, right? So we're going to put Jesus in their white clothes. And you know, they were so afraid that he was going to get out that they sealed up that thing. So we're going to put some duct tape. Can't nothing get away from duct tape, can it, if I can find the end of it? You use it for a Band-Aid?
Well,
I can't even find the end of it.
Found it.
One of those days, huh? All right, so cut me off a piece, Robin. We're going to put Jesus in the grave with clothes, with his clothes on. Okay. Not so big, just look, all right, put the scissors down. So we're going to tape it up so he can't get out, okay? Jesus can't. We want him to get out. Well, the soldiers, the Jewish people didn't want him to get out. So they were not sure about that, so they took him to a tomb or a grave, and they put him in there. They sealed him up in there. Then they were so afraid, they took him and put him in. Put a stone in front of it. They certainly didn't want him to get out, did they? They were so afraid he was going to get out, they put a big old stone in front of it. So they put the stone in front of it. Put the stone in front of it. Then they took and put a bunch of guards in front of him. He was locked. No way he's getting out, is he, Addie? Huh? It's locked? Say, so it's locked. So they're going to put him in this tombstone. They're going to lock him up some more. So he's locked up. This is Friday. Remember, he died on Friday. We call it Good Friday because it was good for us, but it wasn't good for Jesus, was it? Saturday, he stayed in the grave. Sunday morning, there was a big earthquake. Things started happening. Really? Things started happening. Ask Brother Vic. Brother Vic, was there an earthquake? See, I know some stuff, Salem. It was. Everything went to shaking, and all this stuff went to happening. So out comes the guards are no longer there. The guards are no longer there. The stone's gone. Tomb, he's out of the tomb. His clothes, he's still in there. Where is he? What happened to Jesus? Where? He's risen. Hallelujah.
Jesus is alive.
I'm not magic. Jesus is alive. He's risen. It's empty. See, can you feel
it?
Nothing in there. So Jesus is in heaven. He's alive. Thank you, Jesus. That quarter was Jesus, remember? Jesus is alive. So don't ever forget that. Jesus is alive. Let's just say, thank you, Jesus. Jesus is in heaven. He's in heaven. Okay. Don't ever, ever forget that. Where is Jesus? He's alive. Hallelujah.
Jesus is alive.
Amen. All right, Roland.
Dear Lord, thank you today. Thank you for all your blessings. I hope our family be safe and please let everybody be safe.
Amen.
Good job.
Amen.
Okay.
Amen.
Mr.
Wanda. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones who have me love, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
As we should every week, we should be studying and telling about the story of Jesus. Let's sing a couple of hymns of ministry. Tell me the story of Jesus, and I love to tell the story. Let's stand.
Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Tell how the angels in chorus sang as they welcomed his birth. Glory to God in the highest, peace and good tidings to earth. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Tell of the cross where they nailed him, writhing in anguish and pain. Tell of the grave where they laid him. Tell how he liveth again. Love in that story was greater, clearer than ever I see. Stay, let me weep while you whisper. Love paid a ransom for me. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know it is true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else.
sings each time I tell it, more wonderfully sweet. I love to tell the story, for some have never heard the message of salvation from God.
Lord, we just thank you so much for this day and all that you have already blessed us with. Lord, I pray that you just forgive us where we take all these many blessings for granted. Lord, thank you for this church. Thank you for all those who fill it. Lord, you have blessed us with so much here. Help us, God, to quit taking these blessings for granted. Help us, when we leave this place, God, that we still serve you, not just in this building, but God, that others may see us in all that we do, that we may give you the glory and give you the honor. God, we just thank you so much for this Easter that's coming up. How deeply they mean so much each and every year, God, that you went to the cross for a sinner like me. God, you spilled your blood sinner like me. God, I just thank you so much. I pray that, God, we would be more concerned with the things that go on in our household than what goes on in the White House. Lord, and through that, we can change this country. We can bring it back to you, Lord. But we have to humble ourselves. We have to fall down on our knees and ask you, Lord, to forgive us. Lord, I just pray you be with the rest of our service. How great this service has already been. And Lord, may you open our eyes, open our ears to the message you have for us today. And we thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The city was Jerusalem. The time was long ago. The people called him Jesus. The cry was the love he showed. Thank you.
Father, thank you for the gift of music and for those that you have gifted and for their desire to share. Thank you for Amy today and for the way she has blessed our hearts. And we pray that as we look into your word now in these moments in this service, that you continue to bless, you continue to speak. Your word might be active and living within our hearts, and that it might bless us as we leave this place, that we might be a blessing to others. Use this service now. Committed to you, to anything that you would have occur in the matchless name of Christ. Amen. Last week we began looking at 15th chapter of the book of John, and I hope that you've had an opportunity to read that passage in its entirety. We just dealt with the first 8 verses there, John chapter 15, verses 1 through 8. And we entitled this brief series of messages, Lessons from a Vineyard, Lessons from a Vineyard. And we know that on this particular occasion that Jesus had spent an evening with the disciples around the fellowship of the table. They had had a meal together. They had celebrated the Passover together. And during that moment, during that time, Jesus had instituted for them the Lord's Supper, the Last Supper. He had taken bread and he had taken wine and broken it and given to them the cup. And he had given to them the symbolic nature of what was about to happen. And then in the end of the 14th chapter, he said, get up and let's leave this place. So they're walking. But Jesus is not finished. What we don't know is why Jesus chose this particular topic. I proposed a couple things to you last week as to why maybe he began to talk about vines and branches and vineyards and vine dressers and grapes and fruit and those sorts of things. We don't really know for sure. Perhaps it was because they were close to a vineyard, but perhaps it was because God had given to Israel the title of a vine. He said, Israel has been planted like a vine. And he said some other things about Israel over the years, but the book of Jeremiah says to us, Israel has become a foreign vine, indicating their failure. They had become a degenerate vine, Jeremiah said. And so maybe that was why. Maybe these to whom Jesus was about to entrust the church, he wanted them to know the gravity of the moment and the great responsibility that he was placing within his hands. Maybe he was warning them when he said, I am the true vine, you are the branches. John chapter 15 there. And my Father is the vine keeper. Every branch in me that does not produce fruit, he removes. And he prunes every branch that produces fruit so that it will produce more fruit. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me and I in you. Just as a branch is unable to produce fruit by itself unless it remains on the vine, so neither can you unless you remain in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. The one who remains in me and I in him produces much fruit because you can do nothing without me. If anyone does not remain in me, he is thrown aside like a branch and he withers. They gather them, throw them in the fire, and they are burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you want and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you produce much fruit and prove to be my disciples. Jesus spoke to them about relationships. Quickly to review, he said 6 times in this passage, in me, you can look, they are there, in me. We have to be in him. We have to be in Jesus, admit, believe, and confess. We have a sense of calling. We have that sense of conviction in our life. We seem to be convicted. We may not know what it is, but we take a step of faith, and we step out in faith into Jesus and his life. We can tell the simplest child in VBS, that little ABC way, admit, believe, and confess, to become converted. It's not just being in church. It's not just in religion. It is being engrafted into the vine, Jesus the vine. He says, I am the vine, you are the branches, and I want you to be fruitful. Then he talks to them not only about their relationship and that important relationship of being engrafted into the vine, but he talks about their responsibility, or reproduction, rather. The second thing, the vine has a purpose. The vine supports the branches, Jesus said, and the branches bear fruit. The vine itself doesn't bear fruit. It's the branches where the fruit is. There is power because of that grafting process, because we are engrafted into him and we are in him. We get power and sustenance. Even a wild branch becomes good, and we don't produce that wild fruit anymore like we once did. Jesus said you're going to produce good fruit. You'll bear much fruit. And he continues that progression, which we'll talk about in just a minute. He says that progression is no fruit, fruit, more fruit, and much fruit. You can see it down through those eight verses right there. Sanctification. Daily, we become more like him. Spirituality, we behave daily more like him. We have a concern. We have a daily burden for souls. That's like him, isn't it? That's what he wants, is for us to become more like him. So that progression is there. So those are the first two things that we talked about last week. We talked about what he said about relationship and about reproduction. That being in mind, look at the third thing. The third thing is responsibility. Jesus talked to these disciples as they walked along. Perhaps he picked up a branch from a vineyard as they passed by. And maybe he used it as an object lesson for them there to teach them about their responsibility. Now let me say a couple of things to you about the responsibility that he taught them about. It's not a secret. It's not a secret. You say to me, now Brother Vic, you said I'm responsible, and Jesus said I'm engrafted into him, and I'm supposed to produce fruit. I'm not there yet. I'm not a super saint yet. I thought that was for the preachers to do. I thought that was for the missionaries to do. No, it's not. Jesus said it's for whoever is engrafted in him. It's not for the super saints. It's not just for the preachers. It's not just for the missionaries. You say, well, Brother Vic, I'm not that tall in the faith yet. You don't have to be. You don't have to be. That's not what Jesus is talking about here. What he's talking about, producing fruit, is absolutely passive. Now listen carefully to what he said. You absolutely can. He says it six times. If you abide in me, if we stay in him, it will passively happen. You know how I know that's true? Because Jesus said it's true six different times in this brief passage here. Absolutely passive. If we abide in him. Let me ask you this. You ride up and down these roads just like I do, out around my house, right here near the church. There's a grapevine growing on an arbor right down here. How many of you have noticed that? You can't help but notice when you turn out onto the highway here, when you turn, you go by it, you can't help but see it. It's right there. That grapevine is there. It's just growing away. And it's gone through a progression here over the last few weeks. The branches have been dormant. It's been brown. There's nothing at all there pretty about it. But all of a sudden, life began to show in that grapevine. Began to see a little greenery down there. And you began to see a little growth down there. And you began to see some buds and some blooms there. That thing began to bud out and to bloom. Gorgeous. Their blooms are everywhere. The beautiful pinks and the beautiful white, snow white blossoms on these trees. And the branches are budded out and got those blooms. And even now, I noticed some just a day or two ago, I see little bitty fruit beginning to set on those branches. But let me tell you what I haven't seen. I've looked and I've watched. You can watch this one down here. You can look at those on the side of the road, or you can go check your orchard this afternoon. You won't find a single branch there struggling to produce and put on fruit. You won't see any struggling going on there. It just doesn't happen. What are they doing? They're abiding. In the vine, in the branch, on the tree. They're just passively doing what branches do. They're not struggling with it. It's not a secret. It's not difficult. Just abide. Jesus said, how do we do it? Well, there's a stepwise process, I think, without a doubt, though he doesn't say it here. You can infer, and I can too, that you must be saved. We've got to be saved. That's step number one. Jesus said, you are in him, remain in me. He doesn't specifically say it, but we must be saved. To be in him, remain in me, abiding, the branch abiding in the vine. All of these necessitate something prior to that, and that is salvation. Salvation, simply being engrafted into him. And the second thing is his word, scripture. Scripture. We've got to be in his word. That's our guide. The written word inspires us. He is continually revealing through us as we draw that strength and draw that life from him. His word is continually showing. Memorization is good sometimes so that we just simply don't forget. We hide it deep in our heart so that we can call it up at any time. Sometimes we need to have his word close by so that we can get to it real quick. It's wonderful to have our cell phones now. You can Google something. You can find a passage real quick. You can find the meaning of something real quick. That's been a real boon to Bible study. Don't miss that. But you see, being in his word and studying scripture, certainly, but many other concepts are also important. How to live a happy life, how to live a joyful life. Just take one aspect of the Christian life and run through that. Do a word search in his word and look at that one aspect of his life. Peace and joy and whatever it is. The life of service, if you want to call it that. Just be in his word and study it. And then spend time, again, the word. Sometimes we just need to read a passage and then shut everything else down. I mean, just stop talking to everybody and cut the TV off and cut the radio off and turn your cell phone off and just get quiet for a little while. That's called meditation. Just think about it, in other words. Go ride your tractor or whatever you do like I do. That's what I do, ride my tractor. That's where I get a lot of thinking done, and God speaks to me there. You may find somewhere else. Maybe it's in your shop or in your greenhouse. I don't know where. Just find it and go there. And meditate and let him speak to you. And then there's a fifth thing called surrender. Remember, that's a repetitive thing. That's a daily thing. Daily dying to self is important. It's not difficult, but Jesus said, you've got to just abide in me. It's not a secret. It's not difficult. But thirdly, remember this. It's not for mine and your glory. It's for God's glory. Jesus said, my Father is glorified by this. You must be in him. You must abide in him. You must bear fruit for him. And the scripture over and over, John 15:4, Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Jesus said, remain in me and I in you. Just as a branch is unable to produce fruit by itself unless it remains in the vine, so neither can you unless you remain in me. It's not a secret. It's not hard. And it's not for our glory. But we must abide, Jesus said. Now, let me give you one final thought about this. Stay with me here, because this may grab you like it did me. In the line of responsibility, the quality of the fruit that I produce is not up to me. And it's not up to you. It's up to him. He will produce through you and me the quality of fruit we are to abide. The quantity of fruit that you and I produce is not up to us. It's up to him. We are to abide. He will produce however much he wants through us. He will bring what kind of fruit and the quality of it that he wants. If we could just bear this truth and grasp it and hold on to it, bearing fruit is the business of the branch, but it is about abiding. It is not for my glory. It is not for your glory, but it is for his. And he will bring it to pass. So grasp that truth from the third lesson about responsibility. Fourthly, lesson number four. I think he talks to them in this final truth about reality. Reality. The final thing, not all the branches, just like on those two things, not all of us bear the same quantity. And we are not responsible for that. Not all of us bear the same quality. We're not responsible for that. We are responsible for abiding and bearing fruit. But Jesus said this. Here, I want you to see a picture. Notice again in verse 2. And there are two important things that he said there. Every branch. Did you hear that? Every branch. There is no branch that is overlooked. There is no branch that is left out. There is not a single branch that is not dealt with in some way. Every branch in me. So that's the first thing that I want you to see in this picture here. Every branch is considered, and it's every branch that is in him. Every branch in me. Now, here's the truth that he tells to us in the reality of this situation. Some branches are not producing. Some are not producing. He said, every branch in me that does not produce fruit. Now, I want to hasten to tell you something here that I think maybe it causes problems for us sometimes, particularly when we read this passage. Some theologians treat that particular part of that passage harshly. They say, every branch in me that does not produce fruit, he removes. What does that say? He cuts them out. Oh, now, wait a minute, Brother B. Wait a minute, Brother Austin. I know I heard both of y'all say it. If I'm in him, I can't be out of him. Mainly because he's not going to cut me out, right? Once I have his salvation, the Baptist church believes it once saved, always saved. Once I have salvation, I can't lose it. I can't get rid of it. I can't lose it. The key to it is, do you really have it? You know, have you ever really been engrafted into the vine? But the best translation of that verse, every branch in me that does not produce fruit, he removes. Now, I'm not real sure that is the very best language that we could have used there on that verse. He removes. You know what the literal translation of the Greek right here is? The literal translation is, every branch in me that does not produce fruit, he lifts up or raises higher. Now note that. Mark that down somewhere. Every branch that does not produce fruit, he lifts up or raises higher. Here's the picture. Sometimes you see a branch that's still attached. It's still in the vine. It's still getting life-giving sustenance. But for some reason, it is laying down. It may be trapped down in the mud. It may be caught in the dirt. It may not be able to pick itself up out of the dirt. The leaves may be covered over with mud, and they may not be able to get sunlight as they need. They may not be able to get moisture as they need. And for some reason, that branch is dirty, and it can't absorb, and it can't function. It's caught down in the mud. And the vineyard owner, the vine dresser, the gardener, takes it, and he raises it up, and he props it up. Maybe he ties it up, but he lifts it up or raises it higher to get it in a position so that it can get moisture, get it in a position so that it can get light from above and become what? A productive branch. Every branch is dealt with, and some don't bear fruit. What's the lesson there? Not that if you don't do it right, he cuts you out and you're done, as some harshly say. The lesson is this. Jesus, on a personal level, may look at us and we may be laying kind of low. We may be trapped down in the mud for some reason. We may be barren and unfruitful. And God reaches into our life, and in Christ, he raises us up. and he lifts us to a new level, and he challenges us by so doing to grow and to produce and to produce fruit. Now, Hebrews chapter 12 says an interesting thing to us. In chapter 12, verse 5 and 6, the scripture says, "My son, do not take the Lord's discipline lightly or faint when you are reproved by him, for the Lord disciplines the one he loves and punishes every son he receives." Now, you see what he's saying there? He may discipline us. He may chastise us. He may scourge us. But all of this is designed to lead us to repentance and to fruit bearing, fruitful production. Chastisement, according to the book of Hebrews, is proof of his love. My son, proof of relationship to him. Let me just ask you this morning. Has God been challenging you? Has he reached into your limb of life, if you will, and has said to you, where is your fruitfulness? Why is there not fruit production here? Is he challenging you? Is he chastising you? Is he scourging you? Let me urge you, run to him, not away from him. That's not a sign that he hates you, he doesn't love you, and he's going to cut you off because you're not producing. It's a sign that he wants to lift you up and challenge you to production. Every branch, he says. Now, notice also, some of the branches were not producing, but some were. And he deals with them too. What does he do to them? The passage told us clearly. Even the ones that are producing, he prunes. He trims. You know how we do? You go out about this time of the year, a little late now, but it's time to do it. You trim those suckers off, the cross branches that are messing up the other thing, that are banging against one another when the wind is blowing or when things are moving around. The suckers and the misshapen branches and the bad buds, he nips those off. Not the whole thing. Just that bad part that cut those suckers off. Basically, here's the key. What you do when you prune that tree or you prune that bush or you prune that vine, anything that is consuming needed life and is not contributing to producing fruit must go. Anything. Everything. That's what he's challenging you. That's what he's challenging me about. Anything that consumes life without contributing to fruit production must go. Sometimes he purges. Sometimes he purifies. Sometimes we think, oh, it's painful. But he's leading us to production. He's leading us to fruitfulness. He is the vine dresser, the vineyard owner, and he cares. Let me say this to you at the end of that point. He is never closer to us than when he is ministering to us like that. Secondly, not only is there a picture there, but there's a problem. You find it in verse 6. Verse 6, Jesus said, "If anyone does not remain in me, he is thrown aside like a branch, and he withers." There's a problem there because, again, I say to you, as I said a moment ago, not every branch responds properly to the gardener. Some don't remain in him. Some don't abide. Now, I want you to know carefully here. If this morning, if for some reason you don't feel as close to God, particularly after looking at this passage and hearing the truth of it, if you don't feel as close to God, if you don't feel as if you and God are as close as you once did, let me ask you, who moved? Who moved? Jesus said, if anyone doesn't remain in me, he is thrown aside like a branch and he withers. Now note carefully here, verse 6. Somewhere, make a note of this. Write yourself a note. This is not a salvation text. This is not in that passage about relationship. This is about fellowship. This is a fellowship text. Don't read this as a salvation text. He is not going to cut you and me out of the vine. That would say you lost your salvation and I can lose my salvation. That's not what he's saying. That's not at all what he's saying. But there can be loss of fellowship when we don't abide. This is a fellowship text, and we can lose fellowship. He uses the term cast out, thrown aside. And notice he says, like a branch. What do you do with the branch? Well, he doesn't say that the branches are cut off like that, and then they gather them all up, and they throw them in the fire. What he's saying is, as like a branch. Notice he says, verse 6, read it again. If anyone does not remain in me, he is thrown aside, and he is like a branch, and he withers. He withers. It doesn't say you are cut out and you lose that salvation, that relationship. You cannot lose that relationship. I've used this illustration with you before, but I'll remind you about it again. I went to visit the cemetery not too very long ago where my father is buried. I walked around there and I looked at his monument and I thought about a lot of different things. He has a monument, got a granite monument. We cleaned it off real good and got everything straightened up about it. He has a service monument. But I read those dates and names and things again. I realized my father has been gone for 40 plus years. For 41 years now, my father has been dead. And I've missed him every day in that time. But guess what? I don't have any fellowship with him anymore because he's dead. He's been gone for 40 plus years, and I've missed that fellowship so much, but I am still his son, and he is still my father. It says so on that gravestone, J.P. Walsh, and that won't ever change. And you can go to courthouse records, and you can go to the Department of Health and other places, you can check. It verifies in there that I was born to my mother as his son, and that won't ever change. You could erase it off of that monument. You could do 10,000 other things, and nothing would change that. I haven't had any fellowship with him, and I've missed it every day that he's been gone. But that life-drawing fellowship that I enjoyed so much, that we enjoyed with each other, but you can't change that relationship. The fellowship was gone when he passed away, but not my relationship. It cannot and will not change. Same thing is true of us in Christ. Our branch can wither because we don't remain in him, because something changes if you're not as close to God. Who moved? Who moved? Second thing that can happen, loss of vitality. No life. Dead dries up. Where there used to be fullness and greatness, there's now emptiness. Where there used to be strength and power in your life, there's now weakness. Where there used to be life, there's now deadness. What happened? Maybe you stopped abiding. Maybe you stopped the flow of that life-giving juice from that vine into the branch, from him into you. It can also be loss of reward. Loss of reward as well. Only if we are fruitful. Only if we are a fruitful branch will we have rewards. Some of you say, well, Brother Vic, I'm not too concerned about doing that. I'm not, like I said, I'm not a super saint. I'm not that tall yet, and I'm not really worried. I just want to get in. If I just get in by the skin of my teeth, I'll be happy. You don't want to do that. You don't want to do that, because Scripture teaches us by 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Look at these verses, verse 13. Each one's work will become obvious, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire. The fire will test the quality of each one's work. If anyone's work that he has built survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, it will be lost, but he will be saved. Yet it will be like an escape through fire. The Scripture says that we gain rewards. We gain crowns, not for us to wear, but to lay at his feet. To lay at his feet. That's what verse 6 is talking about. That's what he's trying to teach us here. If anyone does not remain in me, he is thrown aside like a branch. And he withers. Not that he's cut out. That passage says if his work is burned up, it'll be lost, but he will be saved. By the skin of your teeth, you get in. Yet it will be an escape through fire, what would you lay at his feet? What he's teaching us in this passage is about the reality and the responsibility of Jesus said, I am the vine. You are engrafted. Have you been genuinely saved? Have you been engrafted into him such that you can never, 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 ever be lost? If you haven't, and you don't know that you know that you know that you know, you can know today. Are you abiding in him day by day, moment by moment, in the vine, drawing that life-giving justice, life-giving juice through the vine into the branch? Are you bearing fruit? Are you bearing fruit from him? Is he performing that purifying, purging ministry in your life, pruning you? Because that's what he does in love. I am the vine. You are the branches. That's a lesson from the vineyard. Pray with me, Father. Help in this simple passage that we might see a reflection of ourselves, and as we look into that mirror, that we might know that we know that we know that we know we're saved today, or if not, help us to know that we need to be saved before it's everlastingly too late. And in this moment, this morning, in this invitation time, help someone to come to you in repentance and faith and to trust you publicly before it's everlastingly too late. We pray that this invitation might bring honor and glory to you. Maybe someone would come on transfer of a letter in any other way that we receive members of the Gillsburg Baptist Church. Help us this morning that we might get into you being engrafted into the vine where we will remain forever and forever. Help us to follow the progression from perhaps today no fruit to fruit to more fruit to much fruit. Bless us that we might become fruitful branches in the vine. In the matchless name of Christ, we pray. Stand quietly to your feet. Brother Doug's going to lead us in a hymn of invitation.